as I said to all the 242 viewers, I would like to say namaste, or in the local language, kaalai vanakkam, indha naal iniya naal. Has already been introduced, I don't have to reintroduce myself. I work in this institution. Until recently, I was professor and head. Last 6 months, I have handed over the headship, but I continue to be with this institution. I am here last 34 years. I have fond memories of my association with the Association of Anatomists Tamil Nadu. And today I consider this video lecture to be some kind of a, you know, returning the Nandri Kadan. You mean, I hope you understand this term. Nandri Kadan, because in my formative years, we did not have a local state chapter and there was only a national body. There were some reasons where it was difficult for all of us to attend almost every national conference. The nearest state conference that was accessible to me as a postgraduate student and then in my initial days as lecturer was the Tamil Nadu chapter. So I have very, very fond memories of the chapter conferences at Sri Ramachandra Medical College, Porur, Chengalpet, Madurai, and a few centers. So it's nice that this forum, Anatomical Association Tamil Nadu, gave me an opportunity to look at things in a research perspective. I heard and saw several papers and deliberations that took place. In a way, it has nurtured my critical thinking on research lines. So therefore, this pranam is to the Association of Anatomists, Tamil Nadu. Next. This slide is one of my favorites. There are two aspects in curriculum implementation. One, of course, is the student who has to digest whatever we implement. And second is the teacher who has to actually implement, keeping in mind whether it is digestible for the student. But then, we have our own problems. So I understand that here is an audience which is both teachers and students. Therefore, this slide is an audit, internal audit for us teachers. We are short-staffed. We have so many other problems related to this. Too many courses, too few teachers, and touch wood, as I am talking, your institution may have started another course. Anyway, whatever it is, there is also a lot of staff leaving either by resignation or there's a lot of attrition for various reasons. Next. As far as students are concerned, in the context in which I am talking, there are two types of students. One is certificate ready student and a competence ready student. As things stand, by and large, our students are doing extremely well in their clinical careers. But during the formative years, there are certain concerns. Concerns because there are so many issues at an admin level which we need to handle. But we need to drive our students, motivate our students from, you know, not just mugging up from textbooks and appearing in the exams. That will give you a certificate, but that may not make you a competent doctor. So it is the responsibility of us teachers to train students not merely to pass the exam, but also to face the community. Therefore, I believe CBME is an effort in this direction. Doesn't mean the previous curriculum was defective. There were patches, there were loops that need to be patched, and it was believed that one of the features of CBME should be bridging this gap from an exam-oriented approach to a more practical-oriented or a community-centered approach. Recalling these slides, my previous speaker has already presented these. The curriculum that is being presented now is an outcome-based curricular structure. The outcome skills are measurable, competencies are measurable, and the evaluation criteria are being clearly defined. The approach is learner-centric, as I said, community-centric. Now, that's the salient point of the new curriculum. There is concern in this new curriculum for there are individual differences between learners. Student A may learn slowly, student B may learn a little rapidly, etc., etc. This is very, very important because collectively we address an average student. There may be students below average, there may be students above average. Remember, we owe a sense of responsibility to educate and train every single student customized to his level of understanding. That is why the new curriculum attempts to teach a student at his own pace, at his level of understanding, and fostering an individual learning process. Basically, this is all as far as I am concerned from the technical aspects of this discussion. In other words, when you put the whatever I showed you in the previous three, they are all technical strings of words borrowed from various curricular documents. But all that we need to know is learning is an individual achievement accomplished by an individual learner at an individual pace and watch carefully at a time convenient to him or in response to individual motivation and personal rewards. In this context, if you ask me where is the technology component, technology is a means. It's only a vehicle. It is not an end by itself. All the confusions that are currently going on as debates across the world on this is, we as teachers tend to think technology is an end. As long as we realize that it is a means but not the end in itself, this issue can be resolved. Now, this is the slide of our students, first year students, one of the previous batches, on day one of their starting of the anatomy class. And therefore, raising this topic as, can technology help? Now, you see, this is a starting slide. Let's go around to the more serious discussions. Here is a dissection hall, my department. You will notice that the students are all concentrated on their cell phones. Now, isn't that something unusual? But then, this is not what I mean as technology incorporation in anatomy education. This is not, I repeat, this is not what I mean because the cadaver there is crying. I repeat, the cadaver there is crying hoarse and screaming. Yarukaga, that means kiske liye hum yaha hai, the teacher of all teachers, I am here. Now, that is what I mean. Let's not forget the core curriculum, whatever it is centric on the cadaver. It's the first teacher. Therefore, let us pay our respects and pronouns to this cadaver, our first teacher, and start the discussion. Now, you see, in the name of compulsion that every student should physically be present in my lecture, I'm sure even the new curriculum compels that. We need to change it. Is there, when you look at several reasons why this sleep patterns are very active during lectures, you will just remember this particular song. I was madam that this song will play very low voice, but if you can catch what it is, I will give you the description a little later. Now, hear the song, please. You see, the student is bombarded with so much of information. He is confused. Okay, forget this photograph. He is confused. He is asking God, can I have the benefit of two boons? Now, what are the two boons he is asking? One is a mind to cross this examination. Second, a mind to understand the subject. Now, the question is, he doesn't know what he should do justice to which one, which is the priority. Given the priority, obviously, passing the exam is his first priority. Now, therefore, it is going to be a Herculean job through the CBME curriculum to bring in a balance between the two. How far we will succeed or how far we will fail, only time can say. But let's keep our ear to the ground and watch what's happening and take correct steps to bring our students into the larger community-centric trained teachers. Let's understand what the students want. They like to participate in the learning process. Okay, they are not very happy with these didactic lectures. They want independence, they want connectivity, they want socio-experiential learning. They want easy access to the staggering amount of knowledge available at their fingertips. Present day students, please remember when we were students, the book, the Bible of anatomy, every student had to read was Gray's Anatomy. But today, you are lucky because you have filtered versions of Gray's Anatomy, which has been customized to suit various levels of curricula across the world. So that way, you students are lucky. And it is also warranted because there is so much huge quantum of knowledge. There is no way you can go through the entire Gray's Anatomy as we did in our days. Next, students also want, these are the items I have mentioned, we know all these. They want distilled information, filtered information from an ocean of content on the net, customized to their curricular needs. Next, it is not that we are not all into the technology at all and we are starting. No, technology is already percolated into the system. I am sure some of your seniors would have told you that there are certain postgraduate entrance exams where picture-based, video-based, scenario-based evaluation has already started. Now, let me put it very clearly. No effort in curricular reforms is successful until there is an evaluation system that recognizes it and incorporates what you learn through technology into the evaluation system. Therefore, there is a need for a backup from the university level. Now you see, let's start. Now from this point onwards, I'm going to take you through a panoramic tour, a conducted tour across a series of scenarios where anatomy and its clinical relevance can be best emphasized or brought out using technology. Now, I am going to play a song once again. Listen to the song carefully. After the song, I will tell you what is the purpose of that tune in this particular discussion. Now, here is the tune. Explain the tune. In simple words, this is a very popular tune in Tamil. It asks, Vandha naal mudal, indha naal varai, edhum maaravillai, manidhan maarivittan. Now you see, let's apply it in our context. When you apply it in our context, that is anatomy context, this is what it means. You see, Dissection மாறவில்லை. Dissection hasn't changed, but perception has changed. I repeat. Dissection மாறவில்லை. ஆனால் நம்ம perception மாறிவிட்டது. That's the point I'm trying to raise by this song. Next. You see, what I mean is, our perception of what we know only as a dissected human body in human anatomy, cadaveric anatomy, has now exploded into a new science or a new add-on science called imaging anatomy. Therefore, with increasing loads of imaging modalities coming into the system, the time has come either to incorporate these appropriately or optimally into the existing anatomy teaching, or if this is not possible, to allot a separate, to create a separate entity called imaging anatomy. It also re-emphasizes certain aspects of anatomy teaching which was done not with that aggressiveness in the previous years, like for example, surface marking. My previous speaker, Honorable Professor Vishram Singh, brought this out. Now, surface marking is going to become even more relevant with the increasing introduction of an image-based approach. Most conservative and semi-conservative diagnostic and therapeutic procedures are entirely going to be image-based. That means you are not learning anatomy to do complicated surgeries, but you are learning anatomy to do ground-level interventions. As Professor Vishram Singh pointed out, you are a barefoot doctor. At the village level, when you go, if you have enough anatomy to make a small incision and remove the pus, the purpose of education is solved. Things like that, smaller interventions with strong anatomical confidence is the need of the day. So, to that extent, we need to reorient ourselves. Therefore, can technology help? You see, living anatomy. It's either a new domain being added, or if it warrants, let's give it and make it a new science. Next. If in this direction, there is going to be a lot of changes both at the teaching level as well as in the evaluation levels. We are not yet ready at the evaluation stage, but we have already started the teaching aspect of it. Even your atlases are going to change. Let's take a look at what will be the future atlas of anatomy. Watch carefully this animation. This is Netter's atlas. I had the opportunity to make this animation for that company. You see, every time you open a page in an atlas and you use a device as an interface, that device will bring out the structure in its liveliness, the, let's say, if required, the animation version of it. And let me play it again. This is actually a textbook viewed through a imaging interface, and this is what happens. That particular structure comes live on the screen. In three dimensions, you can explore it. You can manipulate it, you can annotate it, and then you can use it as a teaching tool. See? Next. Slowly, I need to tell you, from the huge quantum of knowledge, we need to filter it and give you the most relevant knowledge that is adequate, anatomy knowledge that is adequate to make you a barefoot doctor. So, certain things that is not possible either in a cadaver or in real life. You see, watch my words carefully. Certain things that is not possible to show either in real life or in a cadaver, probably this can best be shown using technology. Now watch this video carefully. I will explain it, the purpose of this technology. Now what is going on here is here is a heart. A cadaveric heart will not beat. It will not bleed. There is no circulation. A living heart, you can't open like this in a section like this, and you cannot show the circulation. You see, here is a catch situation. Neither can you show it in a cadaver, nor can you show it in the living, and you expect the students to understand the hemodynamics of the blood flow in the heart. You see, that is when technology can take a dominant view. In other words, you see, slowly we are realizing technology is not a substitute, nor can you ignore technology. So therefore, I am trying to present scenarios where certain aspects or domains of technology can be best utilized in different contexts. Now, as this video is playing, this is an example, a very simple entry level example of a virtual reality model. This model is not a structural model of the heart. It is a mathematical model of the heart. What do you mean by mathematical model of the heart? This is programmed using certain complex algorithms. I happen to have done this in my tenure as director of this e-learning company in Hyderabad. I have only an introductory demo piece to show you. Now here, what they have asked this company to do for me is to show this opened out heart and show the blood flow, the blood coming from the right atrium to the right ventricle, there to the, similarly on the other side. But then I asked them, can you put a small drip set at the side? And then through the drip set, I can ask for a drug of my choice. And I can even calibrate the amount of drug I am giving. I'll just give you an example. If I say, if I inject a particular dose of calcium, slowly increase the dose. That means I have a small graphic equalizer. Using the graphic equalizer, I raise the dose or lower the dose. At one stage, I will see the heart reacts to the dose in real time. You see, this is fantastic as far as the student is concerned, because for the first time, the student is being moved out from simple imagination to actually see the results of his experimentation. Can you do this in real life? No, it's not possible. So, technology can offer safe, protected environments in which students can practice dosage manipulations, dosage combinations, etc., etc., and learn from their mistakes. You see, for the first time, I repeat, technology is an enabler. It allows you to make mistakes, and it gently tells you to learn from your own mistakes. Contrast this scenario from a situation where in a theory class, I asked the student, see, I have about 150 students with me. I asked the student, I say, so-and-so, can you please answer? And if that so-and-so doesn't answer, he feels bad. So there is no embarrassment for not knowing, you see. Please understand, students are students. We were also students. The point I am trying to say is, during the learning process, depending upon your pace, level and aptitude for learning, you may have learned certain, you may have to learn certain other things. At that point, if you are asked a question or asked to do a competency test, you may do fully, you may not be able to. Now, if that margin is not given, education cannot succeed. You see, if that has to succeed, you have to give the student a protected environment where making mistakes is not a sin. Making mistake is a step in learning better. You see, I hope you understand. This is one of the critical contributions to education that technology can offer. It's up to us faculty, it's up to us the students to take it or leave it. Next. Next, we'll move on. Now here, embryology is a domain where, see, as the animation keep running, I will keep talking because we are running short of time. You will see the animations going on. The point I am trying to say is, embryology is a science where neither the teacher nor the patient nor the student has actually seen the steps, neural growth, development of the heart, development of the digestion. Nobody has seen. Animation is the only way by which, I repeat, animation is the only way by which you can enable the audience, I repeat, you can enable the audience to understand the finer details, the finer granularity of what's going on in the various body systems during embryogenesis and beyond. That is why, depending upon how you use technology, I repeat, depending upon how you use technology, students can be trained to remember, and forget to forget. Next, I don't have to talk about this virtual classroom. What we are going through right now itself is the virtual classroom as an example. Next, you will be surprised, my dear students and friends, faculty friends. A research was done in the US to find out, it's not medical, across, you know, in the educational domain, pedagogical research, which is the best teaching method. You will be surprised, technology is nowhere in the list. And it was found that across civilization, across cultures, grandma tales being told to the grandchildren is still the ultimate teaching methodology. The best ever pedagogy known is the grandma. Why? That grandma, based on her wisdom of knowledge and experience, is able to talk and weave scenarios in the air in such a beautiful way that the children believe that such a thing is happening. She will say, the dinosaur is coming, all through facial expressions, body movement and hand movements, you see. So it is still very credible literature that is available. Let's not forget that just an incidental slide. Now you see, having said that, the future of medical education is going to be I'll just show you a few seconds or a few minutes at the most of this video. This is called medical video games. I repeat, medical video games. If the screen, if the technology permits, if the transmission permits, I will show you the video. Otherwise, I'll explain what this video is all about. Now, can I know whether the screen is visible? Hello?
Yes, sir.
Can you see the screen? Oh, now this scenario is this. I'm going to play a video.
Yes, sir.
This is a screen recording of one of the video games which I am playing on the computer. You see, I am the player. I am the student. I am learning something. The scenario here is that a road traffic accident has taken place. Two or three patients are being brought to the casualty. Among other things, blood is required. The objective of this video is you as a student has to, one, draw blood from the patient, second, cross match it and get the correct diagnosis, three, go to the blood bank and get the correct compatible blood, four, bring it, load it and put it into the patient's venous stream. These are the four jobs that you have to do in the video. Remember, as I told you, the golden truth with technology, here is a safe environment, here is an environment where you can make mistake and learn from it. Shall we start the video game? Let's see. You see, the game is started. You draw the blood. Testing. Can you see this, please?
Yes, sir.
Okay, right. Now, you have to identify what is the blood group. Now, you have to identify the right bag and put it there, is it? Yes, good. That means there is appreciation. Okay, there is appreciation. So another pint of blood is required. Put it. You are doing it. That means I, the student, is doing it. I could have chosen any of the wrong bag. Oh, wonderful. Again, you have done it well. Now you see, I will deliberately put a bag that is going to put the patient in trouble and see how gently the computer will teach you. You see, put it there. What happened? Fourth bag. Okay, one more bag. Now watch. See, there is a transfusion reaction. Can you do this in real life? Will a student be allowed to do this experiment? I'm sure you will all unanimously agree it's just not possible. In other words, what I'm trying to say is technology is a tool if used judicially. If used judiciously, can help the student in the most important, I will say, criteria for becoming a doctor. That criteria is his ability to take clear decisions. You see, that is the difference between a certificate-ready student and a competency-ready student. Now, if you want to shift the student from a certificate ready to your competence ready, you need to give him hundreds of thousands of scenarios where he can apply his knowledge. See, this was an example of a video game where I never taught him what is blood groups. I never gave him a lecture about the various types of blood groups. I presume that he has already learned it. I am letting him loose in a situation where he can apply his knowledge on clinical settings. This, I believe, is the most important contribution of technology in a CBME-based curriculum. Professor Girija, the time allotted to me is running out. If you say,
no problem, sir.
I can conclude. Otherwise, I have another 10 minutes to run.
Yes, no problem, sir. We can continue.
Okay. Thank you. And please be merciless in stopping me when the time is over, right?
Absolutely no, sir. Yeah. These are all boon to us. We are all so fortunate to listen to your talk, sir. So absolutely no time constraint and all.
Next. I am not going to show you this slides. This is called the Disco Spotter. I would say this is available in my YouTube channel. You can go through it. But I suppose many of the students have gone through it. I will merely explain what it is all about. Until now, in the previous curriculum, let us say histology or some gross anatomy spotter, identify the structure, give two reasons, that's all. Any two reasons, the student gets marked. I was personally of the opinion that that is not enough. You need to use or take advantage of this spotter evaluation more judiciously and extract much more information from the student, and we are losing opportunity. What do you mean by losing opportunity? Let us say I put a slide, histology slide, identify the structure, one mark for identification. He identifies the mark.
Comfortable.
Next. What is this? Let's say the slide is kidney, which is this area marked by the circle. Cortex, another mark, which is this area, medulla, another mark. Next, let's increase the magnification, high power. What is this? Glomerulus. What is this? Connecting tubules. What is this? Cluster of tubes, medullary rays. See, I can, using this MCQ based, picture based MCQ, I can cluster the MCQs, convert that spotter into a discussion. I can convert the spotter into
it.
I can use a learning management system and map the student
response
to a evaluation chart, and the student can get evaluated online.
நாளைக்கு வரும் அவ்வளவுதானே போ
ஜாயகா I call it as disco spotter. You know, students should think disco means it's some kind of rock music, nothing like that. Disco means discussion. I use the fancy word disco spotter. For the first time, I believe technology offers a platform to shift from a subjectivity-centered evaluation to a more objective evaluation. This is also possible. For details, please go through my YouTube channel. You will see the video itself, complete one. You see, power of Wi-Fi. See, what happens is, if for some reason students are late and, you know, you are one of those tough, gruffy teachers, you know, students should not come late, yeah. There is a discipline element, let's not diffuse that. For whatever reason, students genuinely come late and they cannot get into the lecture, something like that. See the power of Wi-Fi. Sitting outside the lecture hall, this many students, instead of chatting, gossiping and wasting their time, they are listening to the same lecture that is going on inside. If technology is so powerful, we need to rethink several aspects of our teaching patterns. Next, I may skip these next four slides because I have already introduced you the concept of virtual learning, that is this animation based video games. This is yet another video game. This is available on the internet. It's called the Virtual Eye Simulator. Suffice to say that medical video games is the future of medical education. I mean the educational component, the teaching component. Given a choice, you can also use it for evaluation, as I told you. In the meanwhile, let's welcome the latest edition of Grey's Anatomy, the 42nd edition. I believe it has been released very recently. Just remembering what a long journey from the first edition to 42nd edition. And those of you who believe that we are dealing with a dead science, a boring subject, Grey's Anatomy is one of the books that has been growing and growing, and it has reached 42nd edition. So, here is the objective evidence that there is so much to unlearn, so much new to learn, understand in anatomy that the book itself is growing behind its boundaries. Next, no talk on technology, you know, help for curriculum is complete without a mention of a learning management system. I am sure most of you from Tamil Nadu are familiar with Dr. Vijay Sagar's discussion on MOOCs. He has introduced you. I know that there was workshops that have been conducted. Yes, the future is such that one of the most powerful tools to implement curriculum-based anatomy teaching evaluation is going to be learning management systems. I am using a learning management system which we have borrowed from Tufts University. We are familiar with this system for the last 7 years, reasonably well versed, and we certify as one of the most important, must possess kind of a background or a backbone technology to implement CVME. However, I am not saying it is an MCA requirement, yes, and mandatory, but we have found it extremely useful. And those of you who are still skeptical, when we bought it in 2013, we had to pay a hefty price to get this. Today, this same software which you are seeing on this screen is freely available on the internet. You can download it and you can all use it. Now, because the university has moved on for a higher level of software interaction, and they have left behind this software in public domain. If anybody wants, please contact me. I will give you the details so that, you know, it's available absolutely free. If you don't want to invest and you want your management, let's take a try with this, sir. Here is the opportunity. Once again, the time allotted is over. I can stop at this stage, Professor Girija.
So if we have some more slides to project also, is no issue, sir.
Madam, you all, that you have to decide, because I can go on and on.
No, sir, whatever you have prepared for this session, let us have the full thing, sir. Let us not leave you with a half satisfied. And vice versa, the students also, let them have the full essence of your talk, sir.
Okay. Then, this one, last item, I say, instead of asking about slides, the last concept we will say, with that we will wind. Is that fine?
Yeah, no problem, yeah. Sir.
This is the last concept. This is called Zoomify. See, this is something fantastic. A guaranteed addition to CBME-based learning, because every one of you, there's nobody in this audience who doesn't know Google Maps. Okay, it is the world brought onto your cell phones or onto your laptop screens. Now that is done by a technology called Zoomify. The technology or the algorithm or the software that runs it is called Zoomify or something similar to that. Now, that technology is not special to geographic scenarios. It can be applied on any scenario where you need to map it. What more can be a better area than the human body for mapping it? So you can even go into sub-classifications of this human anatomy and use this technology and zoomify your screen. Now you see, take an example that if you use this Zoomify and look at a histology slide, first under scanner. Then I use the technology and ask from 4x, get me 10x. The 10x comes on the screen. Get me 40x, comes on the screen. Get me 100x, comes on the screen. So that's all a traditional microscope can do. But because of Zoomify, I can get 4x, I can get 6x, I can get 20x, I can get 25x. I can get any intervening magnification from 4x to, you know, even beyond 10x, depending upon the capture resolution at which it is presented to you. I have used this. All my histology videos that are there on VBS Histomet or VBS Anatoma are based on this kind of thing. So I have zoomed in and zoomed out to my whim and fancy, exploited the technology to bring out the bright contrast, the best of contrast and the best of magnification, completely eliminated dummy magnification. What more do you want? So with those words, I would like to say namaskaram and nandri to all of you. If there are any questions, I will be happy to answer these questions within the limits of my knowledge and experience. Thank you. Vanakkam.